Today in the studio, we have detective-turned-crime writer Robert Lester, whose new novel, Falling Pins, hit bookshelves last week. It's a fascinating story which involves kidnapping, murder and robbery, among other crimes. It's realistic and intelligently written and has already been named bestseller of the month. Congratulations, Robert.
Thank you.
Now, many people have said that the reason they enjoy your book so much is because your main character, Nathan Lisbon, is so human. It's as if he actually exists, and critics have characterized him as being refreshingly original.
Well, I try. In all honesty, I base him largely on myself, at least as far as his personality flaws are concerned. If only I could say the same about his deeds. Not to get too technical, but when we talk about fictional detectives, there are four distinct types: the amateur, the police detective, the forensic expert, and the private detective. Nathan Lisbon, as I had originally pictured him, fits clearly into the last category. However, when I started writing, I found that this needed some adaptation. So many of these private detectives are firmly written in what I like to call Sherlock style.
And you decided to avoid that route?
Yes, I wanted to break away from this stereotype. Besides, they may be ideal for the big screen, but I don't think a high IQ and wit is necessarily enough to make you a skilled detective.
And you should know. After all, you worked as a police detective for years before becoming a full-time writer. From what I've read, you've solved many difficult cases and brought a significant number of criminals to justice.
Yes, I've arrested my share of criminals.
So, can you tell us what makes a good detective?
Arthur Conan Doyle, Sherlock's creator, presented four qualities that a detective needs: observation, deduction, knowledge, and imagination. To these, I would add one of my own: hard work. What Nathan lacks in intelligence, he makes up for in effort. And as far as I'm concerned, that makes him one of the greatest detectives.
So, have other works of crime fiction influenced your writing?
Oh, everyone who writes crime fiction is influenced by other authors. It's impossible not to be. There is a difference between copying and taking inspiration, and it is not a bad thing to be inspired by the greats. When I was a schoolboy, my English teacher told me, "If you want to learn to write, you need to read great writers." Even now, I still take this advice to heart. There is no way to teach yourself to write, but reading will give you all the tools you need to try.
Given that you have such a wealth of personal experience in the field of modern police work, why did you decide to base your novels in the 1950s?
I never set out to write an account of my own life. Of course, detective work nowadays is very different from what it was 65 years ago. The stories would be very different if I gave Nathan access to things like fingerprint databases and face recognition technology. The story is what it is because Nathan is forced, through lack of such information, into situations that challenge him. Technology might be more effective for solving crimes, but it doesn't allow for the same depth of character development.
Does writing about Nathan ever make you miss your own career as a detective?
Rarely, to be honest. I live the job of a detective through Nathan. I chase criminals, follow clues, and deal with victims as much as he does. Also, I'm not as young as I used to be. I can't go back to that job. The hours were long and unpredictable, and there was also a great deal more paperwork than you'd expect. Not that writing is the easiest job. Writing creatively on demand and to a schedule is a difficult task, especially when there's a publisher breathing down your neck. Sometimes I wish I had more time at my disposal. Still, it's what I love doing, so I can't complain.